Again, everyone, good to see you all here. Let's take our songbook, please, and turn to page number 439. 439. Found your places. Let's all stand this morning as we sing 439. Count your blessings. Name them one by one. Lift it up as we sing this morning. Sing all four verses. When up on life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged thinking all is lost, count your many blessings. Name them one by one. And it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Are you ever burdened with the load of care? Does the trunk seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. On the third, when you look at others with their lands and gold, think that Christ has promised you his wealth untold. Count your many blessings, money cannot buy your reward in heaven or your home on high. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done.
Amen. Good to be here in the Lord's house this morning. Glad you could join with us, whether here or online. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we bow before Thee, praying for Your presence amongst us. Lord, if Thy presence is not here, we are meeting in vain. And so, Lord, we pray, believing according to Scripture, the prayer that we pray that You would come upon each one of us. Fill Thy house, we pray. And bring a blessing, bring true conviction, bring comfort to our hearts, we pray. Lord, we thank You for Your sustaining power throughout this year. And as we bring it to a close, Lord, we open up a new chapter, 2021, here in just a few days. We pray that it will be with Thy presence, with Thy Spirit, guiding us and keeping us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
All right. Take your songbook again. Page 419. Sound the battle cry. 419. Sing it all three verses. Lift it up as we sing. Sound the battle cry. See the foe is nigh. Raise the banner high for the Lord. Gird your armor on. Stand firm, everyone. Rest your cause upon His holy word. cross, then soldiers rally round the banner, ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna, Christ is King of the mighty. Strong to meet the foe, marching as we go, while our cause we know must prevail. Shield our banner bright, gleaming in the light, battling for the right, we ne'er can fail. Rousing soldiers, rally round the banner, ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna, Christ is coming out the mighty throne. Oh, those God of all, hear us when we call, help us one and all by thy grace. When our battle's done and the victory's won, may we bear the crown before thy face. Rouse then, soldier, rally round the banner, ready, steady, pass the word along. Onward, forward, shout aloud, Hosanna, Christ is captain of the mighty throne.
You're singing good this morning, page number 413. Stand up for Jesus, but we'll stay seated. Amen. Page number 413. Lift it up as we sing. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. Victory unto victory is our nation's glory. Till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, the triumph all obey. Through the mighty conflict, in this his glorious day, Adam and now serve against unnumbered foes. The courage of every danger and strength to strength oppose. Stand up for Jesus, stand in his strength alone. The arms of flesh will fail you, ye dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, cling on to prayer. The duty calls for danger and strength waiting there. All right, back to 405, 405. The banner of the cross. Lift it up as we sing.
The royal banner, give for display to the soldiers of the king. As an ensign fair, we lift it up today, while as ransom ones we sing. For the Lord, marching on, for Christ got everything but loss. And to crown him king, toil and sin, meet the banner of the cross. Though the thunder rage and never as the flood, let the standard be displayed. Beneath its folds as soldiers of the Lord, for the truth he not displayed. Marching on, for Christ counted everything. And to crown him, toil
going to be sitting for a little while, so on the third verse, let's all stand. Finish it up on the next two verses. Over land and sea, where every man may dwell, make the glorious tidings known of the crimson banner. Now the story tell, while the Lord shall claim his own. Marching on, marching on, for Christ count everything but loss, and to crown him king, toil and sin, neath the banner of the cross. When the glory dawns, is very, very dear, it is hastening day by day. Then before our King the moon shall disappear,
and the cross the world shall sway.
Marching on, marching on, for Christ count everything but loss, and to crown him king, toil and sin, beneath the banner of the cross. Amen. Thank you. May be seated.
Amen. Well, we are not going to pass the offering plate again this morning. That'll be in the back. If you have tithes and offerings, you can place it in the plate on your way out. Thank you for your faithfulness in giving to the Lord and worshiping him in that way. We have had a couple requests for repeats of the songs, some of the songs we sang last Sunday night. So we're going to sing a couple this morning and then one tonight. And so, Margie, you come and we're going to sing.
Getting ready.
Amen. Thank you. We are going to be turning to Luke chapter 2 this morning, but just before we do, let me take you over to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, if you will. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, in reference to the song that was just sung, verse number 9, "For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich." Turn back with me, if you will, to Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, basically dealing with verses 6 and 7, and yet we'll read verses 1 through 7. The lowly manger bed. The significance of a lowly manger. Luke chapter 2 and verses 1 through 7. "And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn." Not quite ready to let go of Christmas yet, even though Christmas is slightly behind us. So let's look to the Lord before we get into his word. Our dear Heavenly Father, we do pray that the babe in a manger would be king in our hearts, Lord. We thank you for this story of the lowly, humble beginnings of the King of Kings. Lord, I pray that you would help us to, like the shepherds, spread far and wide this his testimony, his story, and that people would not only wonder, but their lives would be changed because of it. We ask for your blessing. We pray for your presence amongst us in Jesus' name. Amen. The world thrives on pomp and show. The more important you are, the more you have to show it. The more rich you are, the more people have to know it. These cars that cost several hundred thousand dollars, it's not because people don't buy them because they're worth that. People buy them because nobody else can buy them. They're exclusive. They're exotic. There is much ado about the children that are born to kings and queens and princes and princesses, always have been, even here in America, where we have no monarchy or royal family, so to speak. We follow the royal families around the world, and we have, in our own sense, our own people we lift up as royal, whether they be musicians or actors or sports athletes. And indeed, many of them get the idea that they are royal and their opinions matter. Sad to say. But here we have Mary, the mother of the richest, the mother of the most powerful, most influential, most prophesied, most spoken about and looked for and anticipated, most royal baby ever to be born. No pomp, no show. This baby owned the cattle on a thousand hills. This baby spoke the world into existence. This baby was the fulfillment of hundreds of prophecies. This baby would be spoken about for the next 2,000 years plus. This baby was King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He was heir to the throne of his father David, bloodline through Mary from David, and heir to the throne through his earthly adopted father, Joseph. Why was there no speculation about him? Why was there no paparazzi? Why was there no excitement? Because they were poor. Because they were humble. In this world, you have to be successful in the eyes of the world to be recognized. In this world, we have to meet a certain set of expectations of importance in order to gain that level of acceptance and excitement. Jesus just didn't measure up. He didn't measure up to anything the world wanted to put across the front of their magazine. Why wouldn't God bring his son into the world with more pomp and show? And why would not the heir to the throne, if there had been an heir, there was no king in Israel at this time, but the Jews kept very good genealogies. They knew who would be heir to the throne. Why wouldn't there be more excitement around the son who would be, if there was a throne, sitting on the throne of David? Why wouldn't there be more attention? Why? Because it never was God's way. The attention of the world was never God's way of getting his message, the message of salvation, away across the world. His way is not man's way. His thoughts are not man's thoughts. His plans never are executed the way man thinks that they should be, and yet they reach farther and more extensively and through not only centuries but millenniums that man can't even see or predict. God is not concerned, as man is, with the semblance of the fleeting moment, that fleeting party and excitement and flamboyance. No, not concerned with that a bit. He came to reach the meek and the lowly. And he came to bring sinners to repentance, those who knew they were sinners, and so he came to the ones who would come to him. God hates pride. God hates that pomp and that show that lifts up man and makes him think he's something he's not. And so he came, he became poor, so that he would reach those who knew they needed him. Luke, here we are in chapter 2, verse 6 and 7. And so it was, while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. You know, we're not told how many days they were in Bethlehem. Because of the many stories that we read, Christmas stories and the plays that are performed, we often think they just got there in time and Mary delivered the baby. We're not told. In fact, it seems from verse number 6 that they were there a little while. While they were there, the days, plural, were accomplished that she should be delivered. Another thing we often assume is because of our cute little manger scenes and other things, is that the stable was a shed, a wooden structure. According to ancient Jewish tradition, places the birth of Jesus Christ in a small cave carved out of a mountain. We're not told in the Bible or in reliable history whether it was a cave or whether it was a shed. Really doesn't make any difference. But the only thing we are told to tell us that it was in a stable was she wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger. Laid him in a manger in clothes that were rags, possibly intended to wrap the dead, signifying the reason for his birth, that he would come to die for the sins of men. Laid him in a manger because there was no room for him in the inn. These are not five-star accommodations for the King of Kings. This is not what we would expect. You can only imagine how crowded the stable would have been if the inn held no room for our Lord. You can only imagine how stinky it might have been. From my experience, travelers are not the cleanest. They don't clean up after themselves even as well as they would clean up at home. Often have a tendency just to leave things the way they are and move on out. And I can imagine that was the way it was in the stable as well. Maybe it took Joseph a few days to get it cleaned out so that there was a stable that wasn't putrefyingly stenchy and even moldy. Anybody who's ever cleaned out a barn knows there's plenty of mold in a barn. I'm sure this was no exception. This was where the birth of the Savior took place. Lowly. Why such a lowly place? Why such humility? Why such hardship? I'm sure Joseph and Mary must have prayed earnestly. I mean, this is the Son of God. Couldn't God step in and do something? Couldn't God provide? Of course he could. And the Holy Spirit led the writer, the physician Luke, to bring forth these details about the birth of God's only Son and aptly describe the lowly birth that would foreshadow a lowly, meek and lowly life. The Gospels are ripe with the similar thought about a meek and lowly Jesus. Phrases like, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls." Matthew chapter 21, "Tell ye the daughter of Zion, behold, thy king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass." Other places we could look to. Why did God choose such a humble entrance? Why did he choose such a humble coming into this world if he was the only begotten Son, the Savior of the world? Well, I believe if you read the Bible with a prayerful heart, from Genesis to Revelation, that's the will of God. That is where God is working. He is working with the meek and lowly. He is working with sinners, calling sinners to repentance, those who know they are unworthy. He has no time for the pride in their pride. He'll take them down. God has been always working with the meek and lowly. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 tells us this principle when the Apostle Paul writes, "But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. The base things of the world which are despised hath God chosen, yea, the things which are not, to bring to naught things that are." You know, Genesis chapter 3, we have the famous prophecy of the coming of Christ. Verse number 15, "I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." God is delivering his curse upon the serpent and to the devil. There are four curses there in that passage. One to the devil, one to the man, one to the woman, and one to the ground. This is the one to the serpent and to the devil himself. God was not powerless at this moment to crush the devil and chain him and throw him in the lake of fire. God was not powerless. And yet he reached down and chose instead to use a meek and lowly woman, to use the seed of the woman to crush the head of the serpent, take care of the sin problem. And yes, it was Eve in one sense, but it was Mary who gave birth to the Son of God, the Redeemer, that would crush and bruise his head. A couple chapters later, God used a crudely built ark. It was of no importance to the people who were on the verge of being destroyed and didn't know it. Why didn't God use a luxury liner? Why didn't God supernaturally produce something that would have been attractive to people that they would have wanted to go into? No, God used an ark. People saw no use of it. It was too far inland to be of any use. It couldn't have been borne by any body of water where it was built. It couldn't be moved. And God used it to save. It's a picture of Jesus Christ. God used it to save 8. They were unaffected by the destruction that was around them. We see similar circumstances in the saving of baby Moses in a crudely built little basket, placed gently among the reeds of the Nile River. Later, God called Moses to service through the burning of a simple little scrubby desert bush. Why couldn't God have used something majestic, a cedar or an oak or a grand fir? No, he used something meek and lowly. A little bush. Numbers chapter 22, God used a donkey to deliver a message to a wicked prophet. I don't believe Balaam was ever saved. Oh, he knew some truth. He even spoke some truth. But he was a wicked man. And God used a donkey. Why did God use a donkey to speak to him? There was an angel there. Why didn't the angel just shout it out and say, God's judgment is coming upon you? God used a donkey because he uses the meek and lowly. 1 Samuel chapter 15, God could have produced a rival giant to defeat Goliath. Raised him up out of the family of Saul, who was big already, could have, but he didn't. He used a small, defenseless teen with no armor, no real training, no sword, with a sling and a stone. Elijah announced that there was a famine, and folks, that famine came to him too. God could have provided miraculously for his meals in any way he wanted. But he used ravens and a Zidonian widow. An unclean bird and a Gentile widow who the Israelites considered unclean as well. He uses the meek and the lowly. He used a dirty, fast-flowing Jordan River to cleanse a heathen captain. Oh, he was offended. Behold, I thought the man of God would come out and stand and call upon his God and strike the place where the leprosy was. Oh, we have our thoughts about why God should do things. A lot of times we think that God should do it the way Hollywood does it. It's not God's plan. We could go on even into modern history as stories of John Newton, Mel Trotter, and others who God took out of the gutter and raised up to his glory. We still sing their songs. We still tell their stories. God delights to use the least. God delights to use the foolish, the despised, the weak, those that are not, to bring to naught those things that are. When placed in his hand, they become powerful. And so we come to the story of the birth of Jesus Christ and find that God's ways have not changed. That's the way he started from the beginning of time, from Genesis all the way to the New Testament, and here it's going to be the way he continues. And so Jesus Christ comes into the earth, the King of Kings comes into the world, and he's wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in a lowly manger. Be no surprise to those who had been reading their scripture. It would be no surprise to those who are students of the Old Testament to see that the Messiah would come to earth in such a lowly way, in such a lowly fashion. Isaiah declared it 750 years before his birth, "Who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, that when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not." God did no mighty work in the palace of Caesar Augustus. The name of God was cursed in the regal halls of Herod. And he did his best to oust him from the land. He was born to a maiden of low estate who kept herself unspotted from the world. Mary acknowledged that. If we were to look back in Luke chapter 1 and verse 48, "He hath regarded the low estate of his handmaiden, for behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed." Look down in verse 52. "He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he hath sent empty away." In birth, it was no surprise to those like Simeon and Anna, devout students of the Word of God. It was no surprise that when Jesus came into the temple as a 40-day-old baby with his mother and father, carried by his mother and father, earthly father, that they just had two turtle doves or two pigeons. It was no surprise to them. Certainly Simeon, being the devout man that he was, would have known that a dedication of the firstborn male was supposed to be a lamb, unless they were poor. And yet Simeon grabbed him up into his arms, and he did not stumble on the fact that all they had was two turtle doves or two small pigeons. He didn't stumble on that at all. And he lifted him up into his arms and he said, "For mine eyes have seen thy salvation." Look over just in verse 30. Chapter 2, verse 30. "For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of thy people, Israel." In birth, in life too, Jesus grew to manhood, and his ministry was the same, simple, meek, lowly, among the poor and the humble, among the unlearned and the unloved. He told a certain scribe in Matthew chapter 8, "The foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head." In birth, in life, and in death too. When it came time for his death, he was without honor. Isaiah wrote, "And he made his grave with the wicked." With the wicked. You know, the Jews executed by stoning. The Romans' normal way of execution was by beheading. That's familiar to us in the Gospels when the niece of Herod desired to have John the Baptist's head brought to her in a charger. It was common for them to behead their enemies. But when there was someone despised, when there was someone that they desired to make a mockery of, an example of, because of their resistance to their rule or some other thing, they crucified him. Put him on the cross. Put him as a spectacle. Such a barbarous way, means of death. Very slow and painful. And so it was that in his death also, he died with the wicked. He died with the meek and lowly. In his birth, in his life, in his death, he was forsaken by both heaven and earth in his death. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Not only was he lowly and meek in his birth, his life, and his death, his message was to the meek and lowly as well. Delivered to a lowly people, it was the common people that heard him daily, gladly, pardon me. When he started his ministry, they came out of the woodwork and they wondered and were amazed at his words and his amazing words and gracious words. But you know, we don't get any further than John chapter 6 before people start getting offended. Before people start walking away, and John chapter 6, when he came to preach redemption and repentance, pardon me, and simple and straight. He said, I am the bread of life. And they said, these are hard. These are hard sayings. Who can hear it? Folks, Christ came to minister to the meek and lowly, those who know they are unworthy, and to give each one of us worth. Christ did not come to soothe our conscience and to comfort our carelessness. He came to preach repentance, simple and straight. Marvel not that I say unto you, ye must be born again, he said to Nicodemus. And it is that same simple salvation that saves the soul today. You know, the modern church today is changing the message of Christ, changing the message of redemption, changing the message of the gospel of salvation to be more palatable, to be more acceptable, to be less offensive, to be more up to date and agreeable. Jesus didn't come to call the righteous, or could we say those who think that they're righteous and think they have no need of repentance. He came to call sinners to repentance. It's sad to say, those who consider themselves to be soul winners will tell the audience of teens that they need to wear their WWJD bracelet and everything's fine. Just think, what would Jesus do? And never even bother telling them to read what Jesus did. Campus crusades and such are reaching the youth with loud rock music and showing movies instead of opening the Word of God and telling them the words of life.
That's right.
Churches are coming up with gimmicks to get money out of people's pockets instead of preaching on tithing. They'll sell shirts that say, Jesus loves me and my tattoos. And they'll have bazaars and fundraisers and car washes. How about we just get back to the simple truth that Jesus Christ came and gave? The message of the meek and lowly is not to teach us to integrate and mollycoddle. It's not to teach us to accept and massage people's feelings. No, it is wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, be a father unto you. This is the message. This is the message to the low, meek and lowly, from the meek and lowly Christ. You know, in a stinky, undesirable stable, Mary and Joseph were all alone. They were lonely, I'm sure. But Christ was there. There were grand parties in the palace where the Caesar and all of his princes were. There were the wealthy and self-important in the inns who paid to have their room and their privacy. But the Lord wasn't there. He was out with the meek and lowly in the stable. And the Christ of our modern churches, our churches are not teaching, come out from among them and be ye separate. We're not separated. We're not taught to touch not the unclean thing. That is very expressive. Touch not the unclean thing. Our music sounds the same so often. Our dress looks the same. Our way of life is the same. Our morals are the same. There's no reproach. There's no bearing the reproach of Christ. He said, the writer of Hebrews said, we are to go forth therefore unto him without the camp, bearing his reproach. Christ is our example. And if you and I are not living the way he lived, witnessing to the meek and lowly, meeting them where they are, we're missing something. And when we read the Christmas story and see that he was laid in a lowly manger, within ourselves we would say he didn't do it right if we're not following his example. Within our hearts we say, I like the way the world does it, if we're not following the example of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, the disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord. And when you and I try to skirt around hardship and reproach, and when you and I try to skirt misunderstanding and water down the gospel to make it more palatable, we put Jesus Christ, the lowly babe in a manger, to an open shame with our words, with our lives. Jesus made it very clear that he is not of this world, and his kingdom is not of this world either. We are to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's our first goal that we are to seek after, not the temporal approval of this world. We are to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Christ Jesus was despised and rejected. Christ Jesus was hated by the world. And we, in our lives, when we desire to be accepted by the world, when we desire to fit in and not stand out, we too reject Christ in our hearts. We too reject his message and his life. We don't need to change the Bible to meet the present age. We need to change the present age to adapt to the Bible. The Bible is the same truth today as it was in Jesus' day, and it will be. It is the same truth as it will be at the end of the millennium, the end of the kingdom. Elijah, when he was standing on Mount Carmel, he said to Israel, he cried out to a silent Israel who was sorry for the situation that they got themselves into with no water and the hardship of the famine, but they weren't sorry for their sins. And Elijah cried out to them, how long halt ye between two opinions? How long halt ye? How long are you guys going to straddle the fence? How long do you think you can get along living like the world and saying you live for God? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. And the people answered, Not a word. Not a word. They had nothing to say because they didn't want to look odd. They wanted to be accepted. Oh, yeah, they wanted God's blessing on one hand, but yeah, come on. Does God really want us to be misunderstood? And so they went on living in defeat with no power, no rain. Well, God did do a mighty work, and Elijah did pray. Because of Elijah's prayer alone, rain came again on Israel. So you and I miss out on experiencing true fellowship and power with God because we halt between two opinions. There's no gray area. We can't straddle the fence. Are you living for God? Is He making a difference in your life? Are you trying to fit in with the pomp and show of the world? Trying to build up your reputation or your position or some other thing that is temporal in this world, your nest egg or whatever it may be? We read earlier, "For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, He became poor, that ye through His poverty might be rich." If we identify with Him, meek and lowly, dying to my desires, submitting my will to His, we will find that He will raise us up and make us to sit in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. I'm reading the story of Hudson Taylor right now. I know he's been an inspiration to many of you, and I've picked up his book and reading it, and you see the glorious way that God has worked in his life and his ministry and his answers to prayer on a daily basis, and you wonder, how is it that Hudson Taylor, even as a teen, got such answers to prayer? And you see how he denied himself in order to draw close to God. Hudson Taylor didn't grow up in a wealthy family, I don't think, but his family afforded what many people couldn't. And he denied himself even some of the things that he could afford. When he felt that God called him to the mission field of China, I believe it was at the age of 19, I'm not sure, says he immediately set aside his feather bed and took a hard mattress so that he could accustom himself to the hardships and be prepared so that that part of it wouldn't be a shock to him. He denied himself and he associated himself with the meek and lowly. He gave up his room in the better part of town and he went and he lived in what we would call the slums. And every Sunday afternoon, he spent time going through their dirty little houses and witnessing to them. You and I can't have the power of the meek and lowly Jesus when we're trying to associate with the pomp and show of this world. We need to go back to the lowly manger and kneel with the shepherds. Started right there with Jesus in a meek and lowly manger. Jesus said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." You're not going to find prestige and fame, the rich and famous, the popular, those in high positions kneeling at the lowly manger bed. But you're not going to find rest in their homes either. If you want to find rest unto your souls, you need to go to the meek and lowly manger and kneel with the shepherds at Bethlehem. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the story and the little details, the many times that we just read over. Don't even stop to think of the significance. Lord, we thank you for, though you are greater than any one of us, you humbled yourself and became poorer than any, so that we could become rich. Rich in faith, rich in peace, rich in rest. Lord, I pray that you would help us to make the decision to follow your example, to follow you in salvation. If there's anyone here this morning that has not called upon thy name for salvation, Lord, we pray that they would find that rest for their soul this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.